Another sutta is 3.13.121. On a certain occasion, the Exalted One was staying at Kusinara in the Wood of Offerings. Then the Exalted One addressed the monks, saying, "Monks." "Yes, Lord," replied those monks to the Exalted One. The Exalted One said, "Suppose now a monk lives dependent on some village or district. Then a house father or his son comes to visit him and invites him to take his meal for the day. If he is willing to do so, the monk consents. Then when the night has passed, he robes himself in good time and, taking bowl and outer robe, sets out for the house of that house father or house father's son." I'll just stop for a while. Here you see the Buddha is saying, if he is willing to do so, the monk consents. The Buddha did not say that if lay people invite a monk to the house, they must go always. You know, the Buddha allowed, because there are some monks who are more ascetic, they'd rather go pindabat, arms round, and they don't want to accept a house invitation. The Buddha said it is allowable, so it's up to the monk whether he wants to go to somebody's house for a meal or not. Then, to continue, on getting there, he sits down on a seat made ready. Then that house father or house father's son serves him with choice food, both hard and soft, with his own hands, till he has eaten his fill. Now it occurs to him, "A good thing, in sooth, for me to be thus served by a house father or a house father's son." Then he thinks, "I should indeed be glad to have this house father or house father's son serve me in like manner in the future." Thus he enjoys that almsgiving and is attracted by it, infatuated with it, attached to it. He sees not danger therein. He is blind to the escape therefrom. The result is that his train of thought is sensual, malevolent, and harmful to others. Now, monks, I declare that what is given to such a monk has no great fruit. Why so? Because the monk lives amiss. Now, take the opposite case where a monk lives dependent on a village or a district, etc. Then he has eaten his fill. Now, no such thoughts occur to him as these. "A good thing for me," that means he enjoys the food, and then he's thinking of enjoying the food again. But this monk, he enjoys that almsgiving without being attracted by it, infatuated with it, or attached thereto. He sees the danger therein. He's not blind to the escape therefrom. The result is that his train of thought is dispassionate, not malevolent, but harmless to others. Now, monks, I declare that what is given to such a monk as this has great fruit. Why so? Because the monk lives vigilant. So here, the Buddha is talking about two types of monk. One is he enjoys all the offerings that he gives, and he indulges in them, whereas the other one knows the danger from them, and he's not too attached to his offerings. Any source of pleasure in this world is a source of danger for one walking the holy life. And we're still on the first book, the chapter of the trees. Now we come to the sutta number 3.13.124. On a certain occasion, the Exalted One was going his rounds among the coastlands and came to Kapilavatu. Now Mahanama the Sakyan heard the news. They say the Exalted One has reached Kapilavatu. So Mahanama the Sakyan went to see the Exalted One, and on coming to him, paid homage and stood at one side. As he thus stood, the Exalted One said this to him, "Go you, Mahanama, and find out some lodging where I may spend this one night." I'll just stop here to make some comments. This place, Kapilavatu, is the hometown of our Buddha. He was a layman. That's the place where his parents lived, and the wife. And Mahanama was the cousin of the Buddha, supposed to be cousin. And he was also supposed to be quite well-to-do, a rich man, and quite a well-known person in Kapilavatu. To continue. "Very well, Lord," replied Mahanama the Sakyan, and went to Kapilavatu, where though he searched all through the town, he could not find a proper lodging for the Exalted One in which to spend that one night. So he returned to where the Exalted One was and said, "Lord, there is no proper lodging wherein the Exalted One may spend this one night.
But here is Barandu, the Kalaman, who was once a co-disciple in the holy life with the Exalted One. Let the Exalted One spend this one night in his hermitage. I'll just stop here for a while. This Barandu was a renunciant friend of the Buddha when the Buddha was following the external ascetic called Alara Kalama, and he cultivated the jhanas. So I suppose this Barandu also probably was a good meditator, because he's supposed to be quite a well-known ascetic in that town, and it seems that he used to get a lot of alms food, well provided for. Then the Buddha said, "Go then, Mahanama, spread a mat for me there." "Very well, Lord," replied Mahanama the Sakyan, and went off to the hermitage of Barandu the Kalaman. On getting there, he spread a mat, set water ready for feet washing, and returned to the Exalted One. On coming to him, he said, "Lord, the mat is spread, water is set for feet washing. Let the Exalted One do as he deems seasonable." So the Exalted One went to the hermitage of Barandu the Kalaman. On arriving there, he sat down on a seat made ready, and so sitting had his feet washed. Now this thought occurred to Mahanama the Sakyan. "It is unseasonable to wait upon the Exalted One now. He is weary. Tomorrow I will wait upon him." So saluting the Exalted One by the right, he departed. Now when the night was gone, Mahanama the Sakyan went to the Exalted One. On coming to him, he saluted him and sat down at one side. As he thus sat, the Exalted One said this to him, "Mahanama, there are these three teachers found existing in the world." "What three?" "Herein, Mahanama, the teacher preaches full comprehension of the sense desires, but not of the objects of sense, nor of feelings. Herein again, Mahanama, a certain teacher preaches full comprehension of sense desires and of the objects of sense, but not of feelings, while yet another teacher preaches the full comprehension of all three. These are the three teachers found existing in the world. Now of these three, Mahanama, is the conclusion one and the same, or is it different?" At these words, Barandu the Kalaman said to Mahanama the Sakyan, "Say it is one and the same, Mahanama." Whereat the Exalted One said to Mahanama, "Say it is different, Mahanama." Then a second time, Barandu said, "Say it is one and the same, Mahanama." Again the Exalted One said, "Say it is different, Mahanama." Likewise, a third time each said the same. Whereupon it occurred to Barandu the Kalaman, "Here am I, even to the third time, slighted by Gotama the recluse, in the presence of Mahanama the Sakyan, a man of great importance. I had better leave Kapilavatu." So Barandu the Kalaman left Kapilavatu, and in thus departing from Kapilavatu, he was gone for good, and came not back anymore. And this is one of the peculiar suttas. There's not very much Dhamma teaching, but it gives you an insight. It gives you a little knowledge about the Buddha's character. See, when the Buddha asked a question of Mahanama, this Barandu, the ascetic, he intervened and gave his opinion. He prompted this Mahanama. But the Buddha contradicted him, and this happened three times until he felt he was slighted, because the Buddha had a great reputation. So he felt that he was slighted in front of the Mahanama. So he felt ashamed, and he left, and he didn't come back anymore. So we would wonder, why did the Buddha behave like this? Is it out of annoyance with this Barandu that he contradicted him, or is it to tease him, or just as a joke? So it is, different people would have different interpretations about it. But this is one of the things where I feel it is, some books say that the Buddha is quite different from the Arahants, that he does not have any sort of personality traits from the layman days. But in the suttas, we find, even though the Buddha was enlightened, sometimes, like in one of the previous suttas, he could joke a bit. So I feel it is one of his kind of habits from the earlier days. So this Barandu, after he felt that he was slighted, he left. But actually, I think the proper thing for him to have done was to have asked the Buddha for an explanation, that why did the Buddha contradict him or something. Because he left in that frame of mind, you can imagine probably he was angry with the Buddha. And that sometimes happens with monks or so, and lay people. I mean, even up to now, sometimes if you don't understand the actions of a monk, it's better to talk to the monk and ask for an explanation rather than to get angry, because sometimes there might be a misunderstanding. Now we come to the next sutta, 3.13.125. On a certain occasion, the Exalted One was staying near Savati in Anathapindika's park. Now Hataka, son of a Deva, when night was waning, that means in the morning, while it was still dark, lit up the whole of Jeta Grove with exceeding great splendor and approached the Exalted One. On coming to him, he thought, I will stand in the presence of the Exalted One. But he sank down, collapsed, could not stand upright. Just as butter or oil, when poured upon sand, sinks down, sinks in, cannot abide. Even so was Hataka, son of a Deva, thinking to stand in the presence of the Exalted One, unable to do so, but sank down, collapsed, and could not stand upright. I just stop here to say something about Hataka. Hataka was a lay disciple of the Buddha when he was in the human form, and he attained Anagamin, the third stage of Aryahood, third fruition. And so he was reborn in the fine realm, the world of the fine realm. So when he came back to see the Buddha, his body was so, this earth was not suitable for his body. So he thought of standing, but his body just couldn't stand. And because he was a new Deva, he didn't know what to do. Then to continue, then the Exalted One said to Hataka, son of a Deva, create a gross body form, Hataka. I will, Lord, replied Hataka. And doing as he was bid, paid homage to the Exalted One and stood at one side. As he thus stood, the Exalted One said this to him, well, Hataka, do things go on just the same now as before when you were in human form? Yes, Lord, they do. But there are also things going on which I did not experience when I was in human form. Just as, Lord, the Exalted One now dwells surrounded by monks and nuns, by lay followers, male and female, by rulers and royal ministers, by sectarians and their followers, even so do I dwell surrounded by Deva's sons. Even from a distance, Lord, do Deva's sons come saying, we'll hear Dhamma from the lips of Hataka, the Deva's son. Of three things, Lord, I never had enough. I died regretful of three things. What three? I never had enough of beholding the Exalted One. I died regretting it. I never had enough of hearing true Dhamma. I died regretting it. I never had enough of serving the Sangha, the order of monks. I died regretting it. These are the three things, Lord. Oh, that's the end of the sutta. So, this Hataka, he's saying that in heaven, it's quite similar as the human world. Because he was he was a person who was very knowledgeable in the Dhamma. So people, the other devas would come to him for a Dhamma teaching. And just as in the human realm, people flocked around the Buddha to hear the Dhamma. So he said, wherever he went, the other devas asked him to teach the Dhamma. And these three things that he said, that he regretted when he died, shows the first one, that he never had enough of looking at the seeing the Buddha. This shows during the Buddha's time, his disciples not only had the respect for the Buddha, but they had a lot of love for the Buddha. And so that's why he said he never had enough of seeing the Buddha. And the second thing was, he said he didn't have enough hearing of the true Dhamma is Sad-Dhamma, the original teachings of the Buddha. And because somebody who is has an affinity for the Buddha, for the Dhamma, somebody who has become an Arya, the love for hearing the Dhamma is very, very strong. And the third one is serving the Sangha, serving the order of monks. As a layman, that the Buddha said, a lay person's duty is to provide for the Sangha. And so he was one of those who served the Sangha a lot, and he loved doing it. Now another sutta, 3.13.126. On a certain occasion, the Exalted One was staying near Benares at Isipatana in Antelope Park. Then the Exalted One, robing himself in good time and taking bowl and outer robe, set out to quest for alms in Benares. Now the Exalted One, while roaming for alms near the fig tree at the cattle tethering, saw a certain monk whose delight was in the empty outer joys of sense, lacking concentration, unsteady, not composed, of flighty mind, with senses uncontrolled. On seeing him, he said this to that monk, "Monk, monk, on him who is corrupt and reeks with the stench of carrion, the flies will surely settle and attack him. They cannot fail to do so." Then that monk, thus admonished by the Exalted One with this warning, was strongly stirred. When the Exalted One had gone his rounds for alms in Benares and had returned and eaten his meal, he addressed the monk, saying, "Monks, after robing myself in good time and taking bowl and outer robe, etc., I saw a certain monk," and he told them all that had happened. "Then that monk, thus admonished by me with that warning, was strongly stirred. At these words, a certain monk said to the Exalted One, 'Pray, Lord, what is corrupt? What is the stench of carrion? What are flies?' 'Greed, monk, is corrupt. Malice is the stench of carrion. Evil, unprofitable ways of thought are flies. On him who is corrupt and reeks with the stench of carrion, the flies will surely settle and attack him. They cannot fail to do so.'" And that's the end of the sutta. The Buddha is saying that if a monk, his mind is not developed, his mind is not concentrated, then he only seeks for joy and happiness in the outer world. And then these are the things that disturb him. One is greed, another one is malice or ill will or anger. And because of that, he will have a lot of evil, unprofitable thoughts. Now the next sutta is 3.13.128. Now the Venerable Anuruddha went to see the Venerable Sariputta. On coming to him, he greeted him courteously, and after the exchange of greetings and courtesies, sat down at one side. So seated, the Venerable Anuruddha said this, "Here in this world, friend Sariputta, with the deva sight purified and surpassing that of men, I can see the thousandfold world system. Strenuous and unshaken is my energy. Mindfulness is set up in me untroubled. My body is calmed, not perturbed. My mind is collected, one-pointed. Yet for all that, my heart is not released from the asavas without grasping." And then Venerable Sariputta said, "Well, Anuruddha, as to your statement about seeing the thousandfold world system, that is just your conceit. As to your statement about being strenuous and unshaken and so forth, that is just arrogance. As to your statement about your heart not being released from the asavas, that is just worrying. It would indeed be well for the Venerable Anuruddha if he were to abandon these three conditions, if he were not to think about them, but were to focus his mind on the deathless element. So later on, the Venerable Anuruddha abandoned these three conditions, paid no attention to them, but focused his mind on the deathless element. And it came to pass that the Venerable Anuruddha, living alone, secluded, earnest, ardent and aspiring, in no long time attained the goal supreme of the holy life, for which the clansmen rightly go forth from home to the homeless. Even in this very life, he himself, by his own intuitional powers, realized it, and having attained it, dwelt therein. For he knew, birth is destroyed, lived is the holy life, done is my task, for me there is no more being. And the Venerable Anuruddha was another of the Arahants. And this sutta, you find that our Venerable Anuruddha, even before he had destroyed the asavas, these asavas are the uncontrolled mental outflows, including our consciousness, which makes up the whole world. And before he had attained to arahanthood, he had already developed great psychic power. The Venerable Anuruddha is famous for his deva vision. He is supposed to be able to see the whole world system, like in the palm of his hand. This thousandfold world system probably is like a galaxy. And this sutta also shows the great wisdom of Sariputta. Sariputta, the Buddha said, just like a king has a son, who is like a viceroy. The Buddha said, Sariputta is like the son of the Dharma king, and he turns the Dharma wheel exactly like the Buddha. And so here we can see the wisdom of the Sariputta in guiding our Venerable Anuruddha to attain attain arahanthood. And this is one of the suttas which also contradicts the Mahayana books, which say that Sariputta is of very inferior wisdom. Now we come to another sutta, 3.13.129. Monks, there are these three things which are practiced in secret, not openly. What are they? The ways of women folk are secret, not open. Brahmins practice their mantras in secret, not openly. Those of wrong or perverse views hold their views secretly, not openly. These are the three things. Monks, there are these three things which shine forth for all to see, which are not hidden. What three? The disk of the moon shines for all to see, it is not hidden. The disk of the sun does likewise. The Dhamma Vinaya of the Tathagata or the Buddha shines for all to see. It is not hidden. These are the three things. So in this sutta, the Buddha said, the most important thing here is that the Dhamma Vinaya, that means the teachings of the Buddha, are not secret. It's open for all to see. And the Dhamma Vinaya, Dhamma is the suttas we'll find later. Under the chapter of the fours, that the Buddha said Dhamma refers to the suttas. Vinaya refers to the monastic disciplinary code for the monks and nuns. So these Dhamma Vinaya are the complete teachings of the Buddha. The word Tripitaka or Tipitaka developed later after the Buddha's time. So here the Buddha is saying that the Buddha's teachings are not secret. There's nothing secret about the Buddha's teachings. It's only later that people practice secret teachings in so-called Buddhism, like even mantras. Mantras come from the Brahmins, did not come from the Buddha, according to our Theravada teachings. And so we have to be careful of any secret teachings. Anything that is secret is we have to be wary of it.